Thank you for coming to the presentation today. As you can see, the discussion is arginine or beets, which is best for nitric oxide boosting. So both of them do boost nitric oxide. There's been some controversy about the benefits of arginine in recent years. We also see a real interest in beets due to infomercials and a lot of different advertising being done out there. So wanted to talk about that. Maybe some of you heard about some of the controversy or some of the things that are being said about these different pathways and which is best. So that's what the presentation is about today. If you're not familiar with the nitric oxide story, it's a pretty fascinating one. It's a very simple molecule, just one part nitrogen, one part oxygen. It's made throughout the body. It's ubiquitous, made primarily through your cardiovascular system and your arteries, but also made through your digestive system. It's a neurotransmitter, so it's made along the nervous system as well as in your immune system. There's well over 140,000 studies to date, and was made molecule of the year in 1992. It has become the most researched molecule in history, led to many pharmaceutical drugs, for instance, Viagra, and there's many others, which we're going to talk about that, too, in a little bit. So over the next few minutes, I'm going to talk about why I got involved and how important it was when I first heard about it, as well as when I implemented it into my naturopathic practice and the results I was seeing. So these are the three Nobel Prize-winning doctors that won the Nobel Prize in 1998 for discovering the nitric oxide pathway. What got me so excited about it was the fact that this is a natural pathway. This is something that your body creates on its own. It creates the precursors. It's also things that you get from your diet that creates nitric oxide. Of course, exercising, nose breathing. There's various ways that you can increase nitric oxide in a natural way. So I was very excited about that. I knew it was something that naturopathic physicians would be interested in, like myself, but also the research was so compelling that regular mainstream doctors would have to take a look at it as well. So another reason why I got involved is that I saw that there is a way that was presented to me that you could verify that these supplements were actually doing what we were saying that they were doing. And it's a non-invasive device called pulse wave. And pulse wave analysis, this is a little report that was done on it. It's a digital plethysmograph, which is a secondary output of the pulse oximeter, which is commonly used to measure arterial saturation. So you've seen pulse ox, so it's very similar to that, but it's calibrated to be able to pick up on issues with the cardiovascular system. So it goes on to say, digital plethysmography provides non-invasive, continuous, and real-time measurement of arterial pressure with infrared light transmitted through a digit. This technique acquires the digital volume pulse, or the DVP, a waveform that estimates pulse wave velocity. Blood pressure is a component of the pulse wave velocity, which is the standard measure of arterial stiffness in major cardiovascular disease risk factor. DVP measured by digital plethysmography has been shown to be a reliable and reproducible technique for indirectly determining arterial stiffness indices. So it's non-invasive. Again, well, that's something that no doubt all of us appreciate. If you can do something in a non-invasive way, that's always good. But it's a way to, quote unquote, test, treat, and then test. So you can actually see whatever lifestyle changes that you're making, giving advice about, you can see if it's actually working. So that was a very cool thing. So I've done thousands of these tests, and we've been able to track it and see results with the different nutrients that we're going to be talking about today. So here's just a few things in which pulse wave velocity testing pulse wave testing, what it is good for. It's given an A grade for cardiovascular disease or risk assessment, peripheral vascular disease, Raynaud's, as well as sleep apnea. So the number one thing was cardiovascular disease that caught my attention, because I knew that 80% of the people that were coming into my office, they were dealing with circulatory issues to one degree or another, and now there is a way to actually measure this and show them. And of course, when you can show your patients and clients, there's much more compliance, right? You show them if they got an issue, you make the recommendation, and they're much more apt to do what you're saying if they see that there's a problem. So this is what the pulse wave looks like. This is a very good pulse wave, and basically what's being measured, APG stands for accelerated plethysmogram, and you're measuring that B point to the D point And the greater the distance between those, the greater the indication of good flexibility within the artery. This is what it determines here. So again, this shows the seven different stages that can be detected with pulse wave velocity or this digital pulse wave. So the one, level one, is the best case scenario that indicates very flexible, very good blood flow, low risk. So ones and twos are low risk. And then seven is the worst case scenario. But to the left there, you can see the different wave patterns and what they look like all the way from a one to a seven. So each of those are showing that that infrared light is either being absorbed very well or there's restriction, flexibility issues, arterial compliance problems, no doubt a blockage as you get into those more advanced pulse wave changes there. So that's, again, what can be seen with this digital pulse wave. So, again, those are reasons why I got involved in this whole nitric oxide arginine story is because of those factors. Another reason was this gentleman here, probably the most experienced doctor using arginine in his practice, diabetic specialist. He passed away a couple years ago in his 80s, but just a phenomenal doctor's doctor. And listening to him is an experience, which I'll share more later as we go along. But listening to Dr. Joe is a big influence on me getting involved in this for the years that I have now, almost 20 years being involved in nitric oxide nutrition. Another reason, obviously, is results, right? That's where the rubber meets the road. That's the proof in the pudding is the results that you get. And it was just blew me away to the point where I was in practice, and then 6 months later, I sold my practice and got very involved in this pulse wave training, as well as teaching other practitioners about the benefits of arginine and nitric oxide. One of the main things that really got my attention was the results with blood pressure. So a lot of people that were coming into my office, they were on some of four different medications, not getting any results, still have high blood pressure. And using these nitric oxide precursors, particularly arginine and other cofactors, made a huge impact. So I knew I was onto something just to, again, with the results that we were seeing. So what does it do? There's so many different things. If you've gotten involved in using nitric oxide precursors in your practice, you probably have heard a lot of the different things that boosting nitric oxide can do. And basically, if you Google any condition and arginine or nitric oxide, you're going to see some sort of study that shows the benefits. And again, another reason why it was so important to get involved in it. But certainly with regards to anything related to cardiovascular, so whether it be atherosclerosis, high blood pressure, triglyceride, and any sort of dysglycemic issues, arginine is a precursor to insulin production. It helps with insulin sensitivity. So definitely with realms of diabetic issues, peripheral vascular issues, see great results with. Even outside of issues with cardiovascular, you see things with hormone balance. So nitric oxide is also a precursor to all your hormones, testosterone, estrogen, progesterone. So, in fact, one of the people that we work closely with is a cardiologist, and he also does bioidentical hormones, but he says he always puts them on our nitric oxide precursors because he sees a vast difference in people's hormone levels doing nitric oxide boosting as compared to not doing that. So their needs for the hormones is much less as they're boosting nitric oxide levels. Sleep issues, because arginine also helps with human growth hormone boosting. Also, anything related to urogenital type of issues, bladder, like cystitis, prostatitis, we see a lot of benefits with that. Again, all the research really substantiates that. This is actually a little handout that we have that shows all these different studies, which we can make available to you. So how about big pharma and nitric oxide? Well, all these benefits, of course, the pharmaceutical industry is going to want to harness this molecule to the benefit that they can, We mentioned Viagra. Of course, that was actually supposed to be a blood pressure medication, and in the studies did not work very well, but the men in the study said, well, it does work for something, and created this whole billion-dollar industry of erectile dysfunction drugs. Then you have Merck, which has a drug called Verquvo, I think is how you pronounce it, for heart failure and low ejection fracture. Bausch & Lomb has drops for glaucoma, so when pressure gets high within the eye there, then you have glaucoma issues and it helps reduce the pressure. Lipitor, these statin drugs, actually the way that they work is by producing nitric oxide. That's one of the benefits, you might say, of the statin drugs. excuse me, you also have things for pain. This flurbiprofen is for arthritis and Alzheimer's. There's drugs for schizophrenia. And then, of course, the more common ones that we know about, nitroglycerin, morphine. The reason morphine works for pain is due to nitric oxide boosting. There is also nitric oxide gas. This was used during COVID, where ones would go in for emergency treatment. They would administer nitric oxide gas. Why? Because it reduces inflammation. It helps to open up blood vessels and breathing. That's another thing nitric oxide does, is keeps the breathing, the lungs working properly. So excellent for asthma and those type of things. Nitric oxide gas also kills viruses, which is a good idea during a pandemic like the coronavirus virus outbreak. There's also nitric oxide nasal spray, which became available also during COVID, that you could spray right into the nose there and be able to even prophylactically and treat COVID issues, viral issues, and then aspirin even works on nitric oxide levels. So when it comes to arginine, this is potentially one of the benefits of it, is that you do consume arginine. It's in a semi-essential amino acid, so all your protein sources, nuts, fish, beans, all those meat has arginine in it, but you also make arginine. So that's an advantage, right? It's something your body already makes. So how it changes into nitric oxide, this amino acid arginine, and citrulline also converts into arginine and then into nitric oxide. But the way that that happens is through nitric oxide synthase. So there's an enzyme that's created within your endothelium, within your arteries, that when arginine passes by, then that nitric oxide synthase will convert it into nitric oxide, and that's then where all the benefits take place. So again, that's one of the advantages of your body. It's something your body already produces. So let's talk about some of the things that is discrediting the benefits of arginine. And I don't know if some of you are familiar with some of these studies, but there is one study in particular that got a lot of attention. This study cited six different studies that showed the benefits of arginine. So then they put, I think it says in here, 104 different participants. And I'll just read you the conclusion. You can look it up on your own. This is the Journal of American Medical Association, dated January 4th, 2006, volume 295. And the conclusion of the study was L-arginine, when added to standard post-infarction therapies or post-heart attack, does not improve vascular stiffness measurement or ejection fraction and may be associated with higher post-infarction mortality. So they're actually linking arginine to creating death. Goes on to say L-arginine should not be recommended following acute myocardial infarction. Well, there was many individuals that had problems with this study. There were six individuals that died in the study that were taking the arginine, but we'll just read how some of these deaths occurred. So as it brings out here, death occurred in six patients in the L-arginine group and none in the placebo group. Five of the patients who died were 60 years or older compared with placebo in this age group. The five deaths included a patient dying of a myocardial rupture following a recurrent anterior infarction. So we can link that to some sort of cardiovascular event But then it says two patients were found dead at home without prior symptoms, and two patients died of presumed sepsis. So sepsis is a very advanced critical care situation. So the question is, how sick were these individuals that were put into this study? And we're going to talk about Dr. Joe's rebuttal to this as well. And we're going to talk about how important his opinion is of this study. And again, he wasn't the only one that was not a fan of this study. So again, sepsis, no, not necessarily related to cardiovascular issues. And then after termination in the study treatment, a sixth patient in the L-arginine group died. But then it says the patient died suddenly 4 months following his acute anterior myocardial infarction and three weeks following cessation of the study drug. So he wasn't even taking arginine at the time that he passed away. So you'll see a lot of, again, people that are not fans of arginine because they have their own deal that they're selling, they'll refer to this study. And it's really one study out of, well, we talked about 140,000 different studies. And so there's a lot of problems with it. This is what Dr. Joe said about this. He says they started with smaller amounts of arginine. They only started with 3 grams instead of the 5 grams. That's really therapeutic. Again, these are sick individuals, diabetic patients. They didn't need less of this. They needed more of it. So his question is, why did they only give 3 grams? And then as they had symptoms or side effects of the, quote unquote, of doing the arginine, they lowered the arginine instead of increasing it, which Dr. Joe was used to using even up to 20 grams orally of arginine to help his diabetic patients. Also, as he says, a source of arginine is from a company whose product I do not know. And then some other things that he noted is that the elasticity did not change on treatment. So this was something that was seen from all other studies when using arginine therapy, that there was always a benefit with their elasticity in their arteries. But for whatever reason, in this study, they did not see any change. Could have been because they used so little of it. The fact that they were diabetic, in the notes in the study, it said they're well controlled. He said that's completely meaningless. You know, well controlled is not really telling you how good or how bad they were. The other thing that's curious is that here they're giving high dose amounts of arginine, which 3 grams is even a pretty, you know, hefty dose, but the plasma levels of arginine did not change. So they give the arginine, then they retested the blood, and they're not seeing arginine. That makes no sense at all. Anytime you give those amounts of arginine, you should see changes in the blood after they've consumed the arginine. So again, there's many things that he did not see that were valuable. It was not a good study. In fact, his conclusion is, there are many questions that were unanswered in this study. In my opinion, this was an ill-conceived and ill-managed study. I maintain the conclusions reached should be considered irrelevant since there are so many inadequacies in the study. So again, one of the things they said in there, why didn't they use the protocol of the studies they cited that show benefits? They didn't use those protocols. They used their own protocols. So anyway, we'll again talk about what his results. Again, we got hundreds of doctors that are using these and have been using them for many years, seeing phenomenal results with their patients and really very little, if any, side effects. The side effects are that they're getting healthier. So that's one thing that you'll hear the naysayers say about using arginine to boost nitric oxide. Another one is that your endothelial nitric oxide synthase doesn't work past 40. So you can't get the benefits of the arginine anymore because of that enzyme not being produced to convert into nitric oxide. So let's talk about that a little bit. And it's hard to really find the studies that really support that. So that's one thing. I looked, in fact, I'm hearing this report about this being the case, but I'm not really seeing the research that supports that. But I think there is a point. The older you get, a lot of things slow down, right? You don't make the amount of hormones you made when you were younger. You certainly don't make the nitric oxide at 40 that you made at 20, about half of the nitric oxide at 40 compared to when you were 20. But my contention would be, well, rather than just say, well, arginine doesn't work, why don't we look at being able to produce enos? Why don't we look at restoring those enzymes to be able to convert nitric oxide? So one thing that has been done to do this, to support this nitric oxide synthase, is to increase arginine itself. So that in itself, that therapy helps to increase or support nitric oxide synthase production. The other thing that you want to do is lower ADMA, which is asymmetrical dimethyl arginine, which is a toxic amino acid that will jam up the receptors within the endothelium so that you can't absorb the arginine to convert into nitric oxide. So lowering ADMA, again, how do you do that? Increasing arginine actually helps, plus all the other things that we know that support cardiovascular benefits, which would be a Mediterranean diet, exercise, antioxidants, all the things that we know that help for cardiovascular issues. Those are things that help restore nitric oxide synthase. Something else that has come to my attention and was really revolutionary to me is metal toxicity. And I don't know if anybody here knows Dr. Gary Gordon. Do anybody? He's a chelation guru, you might say. He's the one that really has been out there and been sort of the forefather of chelation therapy, both IV as well as oral chelation. And it was thought that the reason chelation worked, and of course he tracked millions of different treatments and, you know, hundreds of thousands of patients through his organization, and they got phenomenal results. People that were heading towards needing amputation, or individuals that had angina, individuals that were heading towards blindness. I mean, they saw phenomenal results by using EDTA chelation. What was interesting is that they thought it was by reducing the calcium load in the arteries. And for some, that could have helped in some degree, but come to find out, it really had to do more so with heavy metal toxicity. And what happens is, on the periodic table, lead and zinc are very similar. So lead gets absorbed by the endothelium, and that causes the nitric oxide synthase to not be produced because zinc is necessary. So the zinc can't get in because lead's there, and you get the lead out, then you get the zinc in, and you can start producing nitric oxide synthase. So again, it goes back to nitric oxide. So the ability now for arginine to be able to do its thing. And so detoxing metals is very important for producing more nitric oxide synthase. And antioxidants, we see a lot of good studies now on grapeseed extract and other antioxidants to help the free radical damage that's being done to the endothelium. Lowering homocysteine, and we know that story, using the methylated B vitamins, B6, folate, as well as B12 to lower homocysteine levels. And something that also helps is increasing nitrates. So beets, arugula, all the things that we're hearing about also supports nitric oxide synthase. So here's just a little study that I think was really good, and I echo what's being said here. This is from the Journal of Advanced Research, and it says, many, if not all, of the body functions described in this text are debilitated by aging. Studies have shown that arginine, through its versatile metabolic and physiological pathways, can improve many of these functions. To summarize some of its effects, L-arginine is involved in the production of a variety of enzymes, hormones, and structural proteins. It facilitates the release of growth hormone, insulin, glucagon, and prolactin. It is a component of the hormone vasopressin produced by the pituitary gland. It is the physiological precursor of diverse biology compounds such as nitric oxide, polyamines, proline, glutamate, creatine, agmatine, and urea. As a booster of immunity, arginine stimulates the thymus and promotes lymphocyte production. This may be an important key for arginine's ability to promote healing of burns and other wounds. Arginine has a positive effect on cerebral as well as systemic circulation. It enhances sexual performance in males. It protects from, as well as heals, gastric ulcers induced by various agents. So the summary is what I appreciate. It says, the demonstrated anti-aging benefits of L-arginine show promises greater than any pharmaceutical or nutraceutical agent ever previously discovered. And that's really how I felt about it. I had not seen any component in the right amounts with the right cofactors do so many different things and have such an impact to where I sold my practice and was getting good results with the patients that I was seeing, but it was just so revolutionary, not seeing anything like it. And we see that other doctors echo that. So let's just talk about Dr. Joe's experience, because I think it's worth continuing the story of what he was able to accomplish when he was in practice. So his own story was that his father had a stroke at a very early age and died at an early age, and went through many debilitating years. He hated, of course, to see his father go through all that. And he knew probably that he had a pretty strong genetic predisposition to cardiovascular issues himself, to the point where he went to a colleague of his and he says, I'd like you to take a picture of my abdominal aorta. He was in his 30s at the time, and his colleague took the picture and did the scan, and then he put it up on a light board there and he said, who's your cardiologist? So in his 30s, he already had pretty severe beginnings of atherosclerosis. Well, as time went on, he was looking for some sort of something that would help him. He knew that it was not going to be drugs that was the solution. He knew it was something that was going to be natural. So he used to speak with another doctor, Dr. Zhao, who was at Stanford at the time, the head of cardiovascular research, and he went on to Harvard Medicine, later on overall medicine, to show you the kind of doctor that he was. But they would lecture together. Dr. Zhao would lecture about statin drugs and their benefits for cardiovascular patients. Dr. Prendergast would talk about the benefits for diabetic patients. And after one of their times that they were lecturing, Dr. Zhao said to Dr. Prendergast, because he knew he had some issues, he says, I got some research and you're going to love it. It'll really help you. He says, great. Well, what is it? He said, well, I can't tell you because it's my research. So, you know, there's a lot of times doctors steal each other's research and publish it. And so there's that issue. And so he went online, though, and he found out what it was, and it was arginine. So he took dosages, what he thought would be beneficial. He didn't really know at the time what dosages would help. So now he's in his 60s. He goes back to the same doctor that took his abdominal aortic ultrasound 30 years prior, and this time he's looking at the scan and he says, what are you doing? And I want to do it. So because he had completely reversed the blockage that was there. So he was healthier essentially as a 60-year-old than he was as a 30-year-old. So the story gets better. So he's seeing diabetic patients. So we know 75% of them die of a heart attack or stroke or some sort of cardiovascular complication. Diabetes wreaks havoc on the endothelium and nitric oxide, and that's why all the different side effects really are related to nitric oxide. So he was sending 250 patients a year to cardiologists prior to giving arginine to his patients. And after using arginine, he was sending like one per year. So as you can imagine, that would get the attention of the cardiologist that he was referring to, and to the point where they wanted to take him out to lunch. All three of them asked him to go out to lunch at the same time. Hey, Dr. Prendergast, why are you not sending his patients anymore? And he excitedly tells them all about arginine and nitric oxide and the studies and the research, and they could care less. The two of them actually closed up their shop and one moved to Atlanta. He was in the Bay Area where he get more patients. So it completely changed the trajectory of his patients to the point where over a period of 25 years, while he was suggesting arginine therapy, he did not have one patient to have a heart attack or stroke during that 25 years. So really just a phenomenal doctor, very much missed. I wish he was still around. He was a great guy and really important with regards to arginine and nitric oxide. So again, you know, it affected what I was doing. 93, 2005 is when I practiced, and that's when I first learned about arginine and this pulse wave technology. And so then started training the pulse wave technology to other practitioners, as well as the products I was using at the time, arginine-based products. Formulated several products for other companies after that, and then got involved in good manufacturing policy, compliant manufacturing, was sat on the medical advisory board for several of those, and would help to develop formulations for them. And then finally in 2013 is when we came out with BioNox and our flagship product, which we'll talk about in a minute. So definitely a nitric oxide enthusiast. So when it comes to arginine, let's talk about what works. You really need that 5 grams minimum. That's the starting point. And we do the same thing depending on how bad people test or what their history is. We may go up to 20 grams of arginine. That's pretty rare, but somewhere around 80 grams is the potential toxicity level, so we stay well below that. Now, besides the arginine you saw earlier, that citrulline is also in that arginine pathway. And arginine, along with citrulline, the citrulline has like a turbocharging effect, if you will, on the arginine. So they're like Batman and Robin. So Batman would be the arginine and Robin would be the citrulline. But the ratio of that is also very important. You'll see a lot of products that will put like 200 milligrams of citrulline. But as Dr. Rainier Boger demonstrated, who's a leading research doctor, that ratios are critical. You really need close to a 2-to-1 ratio. So we use over 5 grams of arginine AKG and over 2 grams of citrulline. And again, this helps for a 24-hour release. So you take one dose somewhere in the morning, do another one 12 hours later, and you're creating nitric oxide while you sleep 24 hours a day. The other thing that's important is antioxidants. So within the product, you want antioxidants to help to sustain the nitric oxide release as well. Nitric oxide is very susceptible to free radical damage, so using antioxidants along with the arginine and the citrulline helps to prolong it. And then also, as we saw earlier, those antioxidants help for the nitric oxide synthase production as well. And then you want things in there to make sure that it absorbs. So we already have a powder that mixes into a liquid, and then we also add things in there. It's an astragalus ginseng combination called astrogen that increases the amino acid absorption by over 60% by producing transporter cells to latch on to those amino acids. So that's the arginine. Let's talk a little bit about nitrates, because I'm definitely not adverse to them. I know our discussion is arginine or beets, which is best, and you might sense I have a little bit of a bias towards arginine, which I do because that's where I started. That's where I really saw the results. But later on is when you saw this big wave of nitrates, particularly with beets. So what's the difference? Well, how you produce nitric oxide with nitrates, such as in the picture here, we have arugula and corn, beets is a good source of nitrates. Basically, all your green leafy vegetables are very good sources of nitrates. So how it works is you consume the nitrate-rich foods, your microbiome in your mouth then converts those nitrates into nitrites. Your nitrites are swallowed, hit stomach acid, and then the stomach acid then converts it into nitric oxide. So this has nothing to do with nitric oxide synthase that's produced in the arteries that arginine needs. This is strictly through the digestive system. So, of course, you swallow that, and you're producing nitric oxide through your digestive system, but you also reabsorb these nitrates, and they get recycled up into your saliva glands so that every time you salivate, if you've consumed nitrates, you'll continue to release nitrates that can be converted again into nitric oxide. So you can have a long-term effect of consuming nitrates as well. A couple things that substantiate the benefits of nitrates would be the DASH diet, which is a dietary approach to stop hypertension, which is a modified Mediterranean diet that you can be consuming upwards of 1,500 milligrams of nitrates per day if you follow that diet. Someone else you might look to is Dr. Michael Greger. He has some excellent videos and information if you go to nutritionfacts.org and take a look at what he's done. It's got very, very good. So that's another way that you produce nitric oxide. There is plenty of research on nitrates as well. It doesn't seem to be as much as the arginine research that's been done, but definitely there's plenty of research on the benefits of nitrates and producing nitric oxide. And this is one of them, Nutrients from 2017, Performance and Health Benefits of Dietary Nitrate Supplementation in Older Adults. Now, the other thing that we talked about is the benefits of nitrates, and this is the Scientific Reports, Volume 6, Article Number 33048, 2016, and the title of it is Sodium Nitrite Exerts an Anti-Hypertensive Effect and Improves Endothelial Function Through Activation of ENOS. So once again, we want to resuscitate the ability to make ENOS, nitric oxide synthase. So the arginine that your body makes and the arginine that you consume converts into nitric oxide. Well, nitrate consumption actually helps to benefit that nitric oxide synthase. So, which is better for NO boosting, arginine or beets? Well, let's just talk about the pros and cons. One of the pros of beets, and we say beets, but we're really talking about nitrate-rich foods, arugula, beets, spinach, kale, all these different greens. One of the benefits is that you make nitric oxide without nitric oxide synthase. So if you have endothelial dysfunction and you have a challenge with that, you're going to be able to support ENOS, or you're going to be able to make nitric oxide without ENOS, but then it also supports ENOS production, as we mentioned. What are the cons? Well, one is you're relying on a good oral microbiome. So one of the things that you need to be helping your patients and clients with is to be careful of antiseptic mouthwashes, because they kill the good oral microbiome in the mouth. So that can be a challenge to creating nitric oxide. The other thing is, what's the status of their hydrochloric acid production in their stomach? So that's something else. As people age, right, we produce less hydrochloric acid. If they're on any sort of proton pump inhibitors or acid neutralizers, that's going to be another strike against them as far as making nitric oxide out of their beets and good things that they're eating. The other thing is, sourcing nitrate-rich products is extremely difficult. So again, we see a ton of beet products on the market, and I've tested a lot of them to see what kind of nitrates they really have. We use the saliva strips, and those are a good indicator of whether or not you've consumed a nitrate-rich meal or good nitrate-rich supplements. And a lot of them, the best-selling ones that are promoting nitric oxide and heart health, they have very little or no nitrates in them. It took me 9 years to actually find a good source of beet extract that had nitrates that are enough to really make a difference. So it's difficult also to find a good powder or supplement on the market that's really going to boost. The other thing is that a lot of companies do that I'm not a fan of, is they add potassium nitrate or sodium nitrite. That's very typical that they'll put those in their supplements. They're cheap. Potentially they could be synthetic. But again, these are the things that are used in preserving meats, right? So not a big fan of that. As naturopaths, typically we want whole food sourced, naturally occurring nitrates, and that's what we use. We could have went the cheap route. It works. But we just didn't want to do that. We wanted to find a beet powder that actually had something that can get the results. The other thing is, 300 milligrams would be a minimum, but it's been very hard to determine for me to be able to know how much nitrates somebody should have based on their condition. You can take 100 milligrams, or you can take, and you can see results in blood pressure, which is great, but to really therapeutically reverse atherosclerosis or, you know, very challenging issues, it's hard to know how much is necessary. So, what about arginine? The pros are it is better researched and established as far as the studies are concerned. It's where the Nobel Prize in medicine was won in 1998. So that's important. Again, it's something your body makes on its own. So that's a plus. We're already ahead of the game if we can make sure that our nitric oxide synthase is working properly. We're already producing arginine. So, but it is semi-essential, which means we still do need to get some from our diet as well. And again, we talked about 5 grams sort of being the magic number as a minimum. Again, more predictive results as far as if they're having health challenges, we know a better idea of what direction to go in, how much they need to take. What are the cons? It can activate herpes. We use in our product, we use vitamin D3, 5,000 IUs of that. That seems to help to keep the herpes virus at bay. And then you can also alternate. Lysine is another way that you can do it. We don't see it a lot, though. We just don't see a lot of herpes outbreaks with our products. And certainly the benefits tend to outweigh that. But again, there's ways that you can work with that. And as we mentioned, the endothelial nitric oxide synthase may be challenged. So that's the other con. But again, why don't we just get the ENOS working better? It would be my argument to that. So you saw there that it had the trophy, right? So that's, again, that's my biased opinion, but worked with it for a long time, have seen tremendous results. So as they say, it's my story, and I'm sticking to it, I guess. So what do we offer with our company? So with Bionox, as you can see, we have a full offering of both nitrate-based and arginine-based products. Our flagship product is the one in the middle there, the ultimate nitric oxide nutrition. So it comes in 2 different flavors, a berry and a citrus, and they're all naturally sweetened. It's not an easy thing to get arginine to taste good, especially in those amounts. I've heard somewhere that it tastes somewhere in between like gym socks and putrefied fish, if you can imagine. So, but we've been able to use natural flavorings and sweeteners to be able to make it very palatable. Because again, that's important for compliance, right? It has to taste good. And someone say, well, why don't you put it in pills? But again, absorption is much better when it is in a liquid state, which can be made into a liquid with our other absorption factors in there. So it has the over 5 grams of the arginine, the 2 grams of the citrulline, vitamin C, E, D, and K2 to help also with the calcium issue in the arteries. So the idea is to metabolize calcium out of places that it shouldn't be, like your arteries, and into places it should be, like into your bone. So it's a very complete complex of nutrients. We also put whole food antioxidants in it from pomegranate, camu berry. We put some botanicals in there like hawthorn berry and amla, horse chestnut to help support endothelial benefits. And then some minerals in it as well to help for pH balancing. So that's the one that we call our most therapeutic product that really helps to get people to where they need to go as far as their health is concerned. But for whatever reason, if individuals want to stick with that nitrate pathway, we like both. We actually, for people that are in very challenged health, we'll use both pathways and boost those. So for that, we have our beetroot energy. It's a lozenge, and it dissolves, just have people to just let it dissolve. And that way it interacts well with the microbiome in the mouth and helps for the reduction to nitrites that way. It tastes good. And this has the beet extract in it that I was talking about, very high in nitrate. So it's 400 milligrams of a beetroot extract that gives you a standardized amount of 100 milligrams of nitrates per lozenge. And again, a lot of people have seen really good results as far as endurance, stamina, athletic performance, blood pressure issues. We're seeing nice results with that. And then our arugula super cardio greens, it has 100 milligrams of nitrates also in that. That comes from a arugula extract that we have. So it's a very unique greens product. It's like not like a me-too greens product. There's a lot of them on the market. And again, we tested a lot of those with the test strips to see if they had much value as far as nitrates are concerned, and they didn't perform very well. So even though they have spinach, kale, those type of things in it, it just did not make much of a difference with the strips. So this is gives you, you know, over 33 different superfoods, then also has that ability to boost nitric oxide levels. Then our other product is called Kelinox, and I'm in competition with a neighbor here. I'm going to start yelling. No. So the Kelinox is a very unique formula. We tried to find all the things in there that really help to pull metals out of tissue. And it does it in a very gentle way, but it's very effective. We also put liver and kidney support in it so that there's a good exit strategy as they start to detox these metals. And so we use EDTA, modified citrus pectin, cilantro, zeolites, shilajit, and chlorella, all the things that are really good, like magnets, to help get metals out of the body. So the main metals, of course, are going to be aluminum, lead, mercury, cadmium, and so on. So all these things in there have an affinity for those different metals. So it's a, you know, it's one that's doing quite well. People are seeing the need to be able to detox their metals. They're also a post vaccinations due to some of the stuff that might be in those. They see the idea. It's important to get rid of metals. Of course, we're bombarded right from the air, the water, and the food that we eat with metals. Now, a little bit about the Smart Pulse. This, again, when I learned about it in 2005, the only thing that was available were these pretty high-dollar medical units. They were like $7,500. And now, for $500, you get all the same information. It connects via Bluetooth to your phone or to a tablet. It stores all the past tests so you can show your clients and patients where they were and how they've changed. But again, this was revolutionary to what I saw. I mean, there's a lot of supplements on the market, but how many of them have tests that you can actually do along to see if they're working? And so 90% of the time, if people will follow our protocols and they retest 90 days after, you know, starting their program, 90% of them, you will see results of some sort. So again, it's really cool. Shows them from a 1 to a 7 where they're at, and then put them on the program, rescreen, and show them how they've improved. It also does a simultaneous heart rate variability, so you can show them also their stress levels, if they're parasympathetic or sympathetic dominant, if they're more emotional stress, physical stress. So it gives a lot of great data that you can use as a baseline. Of course, the strips as well. Dr. Sean Green is somebody that I've known for quite some time. He started out with the Berkeley strips, and he sold that to Berkeley Life, and now he's got the MyFit strips. So we're big proponents of that as well. You know, just another way that you can be able to spit, eat, repeat, right? So you use the saliva strip, you consume either a nitrate-rich meal or our products, retest 2 hours later, and then you can see the difference on what you've consumed. So we like to be able to verify and show people that they are doing something. So that's what we're doing here. You can come by our booth. We got the testing device, the Smart Pulse, and we can show you how that works. Got samples. My business partner James is back here, and so he'll help you out with some beet lozenges, and we got our powders you can sample as well. So we would love for you to come by and talk to us. But nitric oxide is something to really look at. You know, whether you agree with all this, you know, that's up to you. But I would definitely be looking at nitric oxide in your clients and patients and finding out what their status is. But because you can make a huge difference in their life by helping them to get those nitric oxide levels up. So I think we may have a little time for Q&A, if we have any questions at this time. Awesome, we covered it all. Oh, yes, ma'am, go ahead.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's very safe, you know, and it's very absorbable, and it's safe. You can start slow if you wanted to. If someone wanted to start and just add, like, you know, instead of taking two scoops a day, ours is, you know, based on one dosage is two scoops, but they can start with just one scoop. But there's really, you know, there's no known contraindications with this. Obviously, if somebody is taking blood pressure medications, they'll want to monitor that to see if there's any, you know, if they're getting healthy and they don't need the medications as much anymore. If they're doing a blood viscosity drug of some sort, they might want to just have that monitored. So again, as you get healthier, the needs for the meds are going to change, but we're not really seeing any big contraindications with any sort of medical issues in taking this. Well, they usually will have some sort of blood viscosity test that they show up for if they're on a blood thinner. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. So otherwise, again, we always send them back to the medical doctor on questions like that, but we're just not seeing where there's a major issue. But it's just, it's something they should be monitoring, you know, anyway. Yeah. Yeah. Well, what's interesting about the technology is that if they're on a lot of, we saw that how Big Pharma has also created drugs. Well, a lot of times they test good. So if they're on all those medications, they'll actually test quite well on the, so then it's like, okay, good, your meds are working. But if you're wanting to really get to some root cause issues and change, you know, your pharmaceutical status, this might be a good way to do that. So, you know, but we're not seeing big contraindications. So maybe one more. I think the next group is ready to. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, brain fog. Yeah. So in two different ways, you know, opening up circulation and you're also neurotransmitters. So both those, a lot of people see good results with that. Yes, that's correct. Yep, that's right. All right, well, thank you so much for your attention, and hopefully we'll see you at the booth.